Okay, so the logical clocks we have started, and we have seen the working of Lamport's clock. Then we have seen its disadvantages or the shortcomings. Then, in order to remove those shortcomings, we introduced or we studied the concept of vector clocks, right? So we have seen how exactly the vector clock works. Thereafter, we have seen that the ordering relations which are there in vector clock through which we can define that which event has happened before which one, right? So this is how things look like in vector clock, especially. This one, right? So when can we say that this particular event E has happened before E dash? We can infer or deduce this particular relationship only in the condition when the corresponding vector values follow this particular relation. That means if we are trying to say that E has happened before E dash, then the vector clock or the vector value of E has to be less than the vector value of E dash. Only then we can say that E has happened before E dash, right? And how to compare any given vectors? We can compare any given vectors with the help of ordering relations, okay, for all the number of events. So this is how the relation in between the vectors can be defined. Okay, so we have seen how can we say that two vectors are equal, when can we say that one is less than the other, and when can we say that two vectors are parallel or concurrent, right, when we talk about the events. So this is what we have seen in the last class. Thereafter, we have also seen one of the example, right? So we exercise some examples of vector clock as well. So is there any doubt till here? You can ask, otherwise we will proceed further. Any doubt, students?
No, sir.
Okay, good. So now today we are going to start studying global state, the concept of global state in distributed system. So till now we have seen how the concept of clock works in distributed system, what do you mean by events and processes in distributed system. Thereafter, what do you mean by logical time, right? Then what is logical clock and how do they work? So this is what we have seen so far. Now we are going to see global state. So the moment we talk about global state, we have to understand what exactly we mean by global state of a distributed system. So this is how we try to define a global state and how it is useful in distributed system. So basically, it gives you the overall picture of your distributed system. So the moment you talk about a distributed system, that means you are going to have the number of processes, right? So number of processes are going to be there, and of course those processes are going to interact with each other, right? So there will be some form of inter-process communication. So the thing is, it may be possible that we may be interested in knowing that which processes is interacting with which one, right? Or how many how many processes are there which are interacting with the other processes, or maybe the number of files which are being transferred in the system, or how much space has been occupied by the files in the system. So there may be number of applications which may depend upon your global state. Okay, so the moment you get to know some information about global state, so it may help you out regarding number of informations which will be useful for number of scenarios. Okay. So in order to find out the global state, what are the things which we have to notice? So the first thing which we have to notice is the states of participating processes. Okay. Then the states of channel. So these are the two basic or the elementary things through which we will be able to create a picture of global state in distributed system, or in short, we can say the global state of a distributed system can be described by processes, the data passes, right? So let's say in this diagram we have got three processes, P1, P2, and P3, and these are the states of the participating processes. So what is the state of participating process P1? The state is, let's say, 100 euro. Okay, although this is not a sign of euro, I'm just forgetting what is this currency sign. Anyway, so let's say this current state of P1 is 100 euro, and the state of P2 is 125, and the state of P3 is 10, right? Then the states of channel. So at present, as we can see, that no communication is being taking place in between any processes, right? So in future, it may possible that these process may communicate with each other. So a communication channel is there. So it depends upon those processes that whether they are communicating to the other processes or not. So the moment you talk about the overall global state, then you can describe like this. So in this particular case, we can say that how much money is there along with all these processes. Okay, so we can find it out by evaluating the sum of all those. So this is how the things happen in finding global state of a distributed system. Okay, now let's say that again we have got three processes, P1, P2, and P3. So earlier we have talked about that these are the states or the present states of all the processes. And over here we are assuming that this time one of the process is trying to communicate with the other one. So especially in this case, we can see that P2 is now trying to communicate with P3. And how it is trying to communicate? That P2 is some money to P3. So earlier state of P2 was 125, right? So after sending 25 to P3, the present state of P2 would be 100. But again, the moment we try to find out the global state where we are adding all the values together. Okay, so in the earlier slide, we were just adding the values of the states of individual processes. There was no value or no data was present in the channel. Okay, we can call this as a channel. So, but in this case, now we have got some values or some data in the channel. So the global state can be defined that the things or the data present along with the processes and the data present along with the channels or in the channels. Okay. So this is how you can define the global state. Fine. So we can see again 100, 200, 210, and 235. So global state remains same. Okay, some of the data may be there with the processes, and some of the data may be there in the channel. Now, over here, you can see that this time your P3 is also trying to send some, P2 is also trying to send some data to P1. So let's say this is our channel C12, this is our channel C21, this is our channel C23 and this is our channel C32. Okay, C12 means process 1 is sending something to process 2, and in this case process 2 is trying to send something to 1. Okay, so this is how we have followed the nomenclature. This, what we can observe, that this time the data which was there in the channel has been consumed by the process P3. Okay, so earlier the data was present in the channel only, but in the next step, this data which was there in the channel has been consumed by process P3, and that data or that value has been added into it. And again, when you take out the sum of all these things, the sum is going to remain same. Okay, so you can say the global state of the system is consistent. Okay, now before proceeding further, we need to have some number of assumptions. Okay, and on the basis of that, we will be studying an algorithm which is called as a distributed snapshot algorithm. Okay, and that particular algorithm relies on these two fundamental assumptions, and these fundamental assumptions are: we are assuming that the channels are error free and they are sequence preserving. Okay, so there is no loss of data, and whatever data we are sending from one process to other process, they are following a sequence. Okay, so sequence preserving is there, and also there is no loss of data in the channel. And apart from that, whatever data is being sent in between the processes or transmitted in between the processes, they reach the other process. However, the time is not known. They will reach. It may possible that they reach with some delay, but they'll reach. Okay, so you can say the unknown but finite delay may be there in transmitting the messages in between the processes. Okay, apart from that, the other assumptions, which are there in this algorithm are that the only events in the system which can rise to changes in this state are communicating events. Okay, so whatever events are there, if we have got, or if we are just trying to characterize our events with the form of some events, then we can say if there is a change in the state. So if the initial state is S and the final state is S dash, then the transition from S to S dash will only be possible in case of the communicating event. Okay, otherwise not. And apart from that, the final one is we are assuming that the simultaneous events are assumed not to occur. And how we are achieving this? We are achieving this by having total ordering of all the events. Okay, where each and everything has been defined by your happened before relationship. Okay, where exactly you can say that which event has happened before which one. Okay, so this is how we define total ordering. So these are the main assumptions which we need to consider before studying this algorithm. Okay, now we have to see the event. Let's say this is how an event can be characterized in distributed snapshot algorithm. So let's say we have got an event E. Okay, and the moment we talk about the event E, then these are the things which you may get with this event. Okay, for example, this particular event is happening on which process? Okay, what were the initial state and what were the final state? Okay, so on which process this event is being taking place, then what was the initial state before the event, and then what were the final state after the event, then what was the actual message? Okay, this can be your actual message. and here three denotes the channel. Okay, so the moment you have any event, then you can get these many information with that. Okay, or you can say that an event can be described by the five components P, L, R dash, capital M, and P. Okay. So let us try to understand things with the help of this example, and this is very very important example. Okay, so all of you are required to pay your due attention towards this. So let us say this is a scenario. We have got three processes P1, P2, and P3. And let's say the current state of P1 is 100, P2 is 125, okay, and P3 is 10. Okay, this is the current scenario P1, P2, and P3. Now let us say there is some sort of inter-process communication in between all these three processes. Okay, so some events are being taking place, and this is how you can describe an event. Okay, on which process that particular event is being taking place, then what is the initial state, final state, what is the message and the channel, and this is your corresponding global state. Okay, so what I'm trying to tell you, that what is the event first, okay, and then what is the corresponding global state of the system after that event has taken place. This is what has been described over here. Okay, so let us say this is how an event has been described, and this is the global state of the system, and the moment you put up all the values, this is how it will look like. So with P1 we have got the state as 100, with P2 we have got 125, with P3 we have got 10. Fine, and at present there is no data in the channel. So this is why these things have been left blank. Okay, so there is no data as present, or no value at present in the channel. Fine, now let us say event 1 has happened. Event 1 has happened on P1. Okay, so let us say over here E1 has been observed at C12, and what was E1? E1 was transferring 75 to P2. Okay, so event 1 is that one message which contains 75 has been sent from P1. Okay, so the initial state was 100 and the final state was 25, since the 75 has been sent. And over which channel this message has been sent? This has been sent over C12, this one. Okay, so what would be the corresponding global state? So the corresponding global state is going to be that the current state of P1, now it will be 25, P2, 125, P3, 10. And this time, the value which has been detected from P1 is going to be there in the channel C12. Okay, so you can see now channel C12 is carrying the value 75. And again, the moment you try to find out the sum of all the processing channel, that will be consistent with the earlier sum. Okay, so this is how we can describe an event in forming a global state of distributed system. Okay, now let us say that we have observed one more event A2 at P2. Okay, so let us say that one more event A2 has been observed over P2, and this time again some value, let's say 25, is being sent P3. 25. Still there is what is the current value of P2? 125. Okay. And then what is the final state of P2? 100. After transferring this value, this particular value, the final state of P2 is going to be 100. Okay. And what is the message? Message is 25. And over which channel this particular communication is taking place? This is taking place over C23. So therefore, we have placed value 25 over C23. Okay. So this is what has happened with event A2. Fine. Now let us see what is happening with event E3. Okay. Again, your event E3 is happening with P2. Okay. So event P2 is happening over channel C12. That means this time event is happening with C2, but it is related to P1 as well. So this time event A3 is happening over here, over channel C21. Fine. And what is happening with this event? The value which was transferred from P2, this value, has now been consumed. Has now been consumed by P1. Okay. So this is why we can see that what is the value of P1 now? What is the value of P1?
25.
Okay, so we can see the value of P2 was 100. Okay. Yeah, this one is again, I guess I have interpreted wrong. This is 21, right? And we are talking about C12. So in this case, the value will be consumed by P2. Okay, sorry, I described wrongly. So in E3, this particular value will be consumed by P2. So after this, after sending this 25, the value of P2 was 100, and the moment it consumed this, the value is going to be 175. Okay, this one. Okay, and the state of P1 before this event was 100. Sorry, 25. Okay, P2, 100, and P3, 10. So after consuming this value, what will be the value of P2? It will be 175. Since this particular value has been consumed by P2. So again, when you take the total sum, it is again going to be same. Okay, so this is how the consuming event take place. Similarly, again, 50 has been sent over C21. What is C21? This one. So let us say this is E4, and 50 is being sent by P2 to P1. Okay, so since the 50 has been sent by P2, so the 50 will be deducted from here. Okay. And now you can see that in the next event, E5, this E5, the data present in the channel is being consumed. Okay. Which was there with the C23. So this particular data, which was there in C23, is being consumed by P3. So what was the initial state of P3? P3, 10. And after consuming this 25, this state is going to be transformed from 10 to 35. Okay, so the moment it consumes this data, we are going to remove the data from the channel. Okay, so before this, the state of P1 was 25, P2 was 125, and P3 will be 10 plus 25, which is 35. Okay, and then event E6. Okay, where E6 is taking place? 21. Again, 21. Okay, no issue. So let us say E2 is 5. E6 is again taking place at O here. Okay, or here. So in this case, what will happen? What will happen? Again, you will consider the set of all the processes P1, P2, and P3. Okay, and since this is taking place over P1. Okay, so the initial state of P1 was 25, and then the final state is 75. Okay, because we are consuming the data. Okay, we are consuming the data. Fine. So, and the consumed data was 50 over C21. Okay, where the P2 was sending some data to P1. So here you have to denote the process which is sending the data and which is consuming the data. Okay, over here P1 was sending something, over here P2 was sending something. In this case, P2 was consuming some events, and in this case P2 was sending some data. In this case, P3 was consuming some data. And in this case, P1 is consuming some data. So you have to take care that which event is sending and which event is consuming. Okay. So this is how we can decide that which process ID you need to write. Okay. This example is clear to all of you. If you have any doubt, then you can ask me.
Sir, in event E2, we are transferring 25 from P2 to P3.
Right.
So P3 should be 35.
P3 should be 35. Yeah, exactly. It is going to be 35. But since you have just transferred it, but that transfer has not been credited to P3. Okay, so sending is a different event and receiving is a different event. This is why I am trying to explain you that sending is a different event and consuming is a different event. Okay, so if you got two processes, let's say this, trying to send. Let us say event and event of P2, or let us say event of P2 of consuming. Thing is going to be a different. Okay, so P1 in this case is trying to send or sending some data 25, and in this case, which is your E dash, over here P2 will be consuming the value 25. Okay, these two are different ones. So until unless the consuming event take place, this particular value will not be created or will not be added to this one. Okay, so in this case E2 is just sending, but as of now P3 has not received it. For receiving, it has to trigger one more event. Okay. And in this case, that event is happening over here. E5. Okay. So E5, at E5, we are telling that this time P3 is consuming. So initial state was 10. And after consuming the event, the state has been 35. Okay. So this was the message, and this has been consumed over this channel. Is that clear?
Yes.
Okay. Any other student? Any other student? Any doubt? Okay. So, if there is no doubt, then all these students are required to exercise this example. Okay, so what you can do before this, all of you can just note down this example, okay, so that you can exercise on the next one. Note down this one quickly. All of it, please. Or you can take the photo, whatever you like, screenshot. If you guys are ready with this one, just let me know. Then I'll put up that question. Have you noted down this, students? Aditi, Anshuman.
Yes, sir.
Have you noted down?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I have taken the picture.
Okay. Purnima, Rajesh Kumar.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I have taken the picture.
Okay, good. So now all of you are requested to exercise this example or this question. So what you need to do that you got four processes this time. And this is the sequence. This is the sequence in which the things are happening. Okay. So these are the sending events. And these are the consuming events. All the dash events are consuming events. Okay. So first sending is happening. Again, the sending is happening. Then one of the receiving is happening or the consuming is happening. Then again, sending is happening. Then consuming. Then sending, consuming, consuming. Okay. And the order has been given to you. Okay, so you need to exercise each and every individual event and its corresponding global state. Okay. For example, let me write for one of the event, the first one. If you talk about E3, then the process at which the P3 is happening is, so E3, then it will need to be P3, right? And again, the initial state, the final state, which is going to be your 1100 in this case, and then it is going to be 75, right? So 350 is going to be your S dash. Okay. Then what is the message? Message is 750. And what is the channel? So if you call this C12, this one is C21, then C23, this one C32, and this one is C34, and this one is C43. Okay, so this one is been taking place at C32. Okay, and then the corresponding global state, the states of all the processes first, which is 1000, then 2500, and then 750, not 750. In this case, it is going to be your 350. And then 10,000. Okay, this one is your P1, 2, 3, and P4. Okay, then your channel values. So C12 is empty, C21 is empty, right? C12. C21, then C23, what is the value? Nothing. So C23, then C32. So at C32, you have the value 750, right? And then C34, and C43. Okay, so this is how you can describe an event in this distributed system example. Okay, clear students?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so please describe all the other events. All of you are doing it or not, students?
Doing, sir.
Yes, sir, doing it.
Good. And whoever is ready with their exercise, they can let me know. I will allow them to present their answer. Okay. So if you exercise in the copy or something, then you can show that one.
Hello, sir. Ashutosh here, BTech.
Yeah.
Sir, for value of P1, final value of P1 is 1350.
Okay, so Ashutosh, have you done it in the copy?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so can you show it? Yes, I will allow you to present the things and all.
Sir, I haven't, but you can see it.
I allow you?
Yes, sure, sir.
Okay, just so you can present the thing. I have allowed. Just take the camera on the side.
So I have done it in copy, not on the screen. Okay, now this is visible. Is it visible, sir?
Yeah, I can see.
So the down is the final value. I've done it roughly, actually, so there might not be.
Can you just put away your copy a little bit? The things are very general. Let us keep this table. Okay, fine. Good one. Fair enough. So, Adiko, since the things were not clearly visible, no issue.
Okay, sir.
How exactly you are doing it?
Hello?
You can describe it.
Sir, what should I have to test as the final answer or the process?
How you have proceeded means after E3, what was the corresponding global state of E2?
After E3, the corresponding global state of P2. Okay, I am
E2.
After of the E2. Okay, so it is a. Sir, I have not. This is rough guy. Sure. Okay, sir. Wait a second. Five double zero. And 1100.
Okay, so E2. Just tell me for E2, what is the global state?
So E2 for the global state is 350 and 2150 and 1100 and then not 350, then 8000.
350, 2100, 1100.
Can I see the final value, sir? I have not. There is some problem in global state.
It is not going to matter. What is going to matter is the process. Is how exactly you have find out the global state after each and every individual event. That is more important. Because the final values are going to be same. Okay, that is no worry. For example, you can add 600 to this one, you can add this to this one. So those values will be come as it is. The exact values will come at the end. But what is that how you are evaluating the global state after each and every individual events. Okay, so this matter a lot.
Okay, sir. So, sir, for the process of E2, the global state will be 1000,2150,350,8000. Okay, sir. Okay, wait, I will read.
For A2, the global state is going to be 1000,
then 2150, then 350, then 8000, then blank,
okay,
then 350, then blank,
okay,
then 750, then blank and blank.
Okay. This is what is there for E2, for E3 dash?
For E3 dash, that will be 1000.
1000.
And wait a second. There is a problem, sir. I have done a problem. Mine is incorrect, sir. I have seen it now.
Okay. So now all of you have got the idea what exactly you need to do in this one. Okay. So over here you need to as well. Example, in case of E2, you can say that E2 is happening with P2. Okay. And the initial state was your 2500. And what was the final state? After reducing this one, you will see 2150. Okay. And then what is the value? For the message is 350, and channel or which it happened is C21. Okay, so these were the state for this event E2. Okay. And you need to remember that this particular ordering, this one, is very, very important. Since the ordering has been given to you, so it is not like that first you need to produce the global state for E1, then E2, then E3. Okay, since I have explicitly mentioned the ordering, so you have to go with this ordering only. Okay, so this is important. If the ordering is not given to you, then you can follow any random ordering. Okay, any sending events, then in sequential manner you can have the consuming events. But if the ordering is given, then you need to follow this ordering strictly. That you need to remember for this type of questions. Okay, is that clear to all the students?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so with this, I hope that all of you have got the idea how we can create the global state for each and every event with the help of your distributed snapshot algorithm. Okay.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, completed.
Completed. Can you show it?
So wait a minute. Sir, completed.
So if somebody is more willing to show their answer,
Hello.
Yeah.
Is this visible?
No, it's not visible as of now.
So wait a minute. Is this visible?
No. Please check out the options at your end. It's not visible to us.
So my video is visible now.
Yeah, now we can see it. Okay. Okay. Good, good, Adarsh.
Yes, sir.
Sir, done.
Yeah, if you are in a position to show your exercise, then you are also welcome. So is there anybody who is showing to, who's going to show their answer?
Is it visible, sir?
No, yeah, now it is visible. Harsh Sinha. Okay. Okay, score is English. Then the other one consuming E1 after E3 dash E1, right? Good, good, good one. Now Vishal is showing, right? Okay, so E3, E2, E3 dash. See, Vishal, the answer which you have just presented, you need to carefully put up the syntax for each and every individual events. So some syntax error is there for each and every event. So you need to very clearly mention what event and what are its purpose. Okay.
Okay, sir.
But the overall exercise is right.
Okay, sir.
Anybody else?
How to close this?
Anybody else after Vishal? Okay, so I guess the things are pretty much clear to all of you. Okay, so after assuming that, now there's one more thing which is called as a consistent picture of a distributed system. So the moment if we ask to create a consistent picture of a global state with the help of a distributed snapshot algorithm, then these are the conditions through which you can create a consistent picture in global, sorry, consistent picture in any distributed system with the help of distributed snapshot algorithm. What do you mean by having this? Okay, so let us say we have got some number of events which are defining not visible.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay, just hold on. Okay. Now is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. About creating a consistent picture, this one, with the help of your distributed snapshot algorithm. Okay. And for that to have, let us say we have got number of events, and those number of events is forming a set H right? So how to create a consistent picture with the help of this algorithm? So as I told you that we have defined some number of events, okay, and all those events are there or have been placed in a set called as H, okay. So the all these events are there in the consistent set H. Apart from that, if we have more events, let's say EJ, okay. So what I'm trying to say that we have got some number of events which are defined as consistent and are forming a set H. Apart from that, if we have got some other events, let's say EJ, and if those events have happened before EI, means all those events, then we can say that those EJ are also going to be the part of set H. So this is how we can define a consistent picture with the help of distributed snapshot algorithm in distributed system. So let us just try to understand with the help of an example. Okay. So let us say we have got two processes P1 and P2. Okay. And we have got some number of events over these processes. And this is your send receive. Okay. Let's say E1, E2, E3, E4, E5, E6, and E7. Okay. Now, if I'm defining a set H in which E1, E4, and E5 are there. Okay. So I have defined this. This is a cut. Okay. So this line cut. So and the state is okay. Now, if in case okay. So if in case we have got one more event, if you have got one more event, let's say, or one more cut, or one more example, I would present, then it will be clear. And it is something like this. This is the cut. And or rather let's say these are the events. E1, E2, E3, E4, E5, E6, over process E1 and P2. And if I'm defining a cut like this, okay. Let me see if I have some good options. So if this is my cut, okay, so I need to consider all the events in the left side of that cut. So that means this area will not be considered. So in this case, if you are defining that what is H, then H is going to be E3 and E4 and E5. Okay. And now I'm asking, is it a consistent cut or not? So with this condition, we can say this one is not consistent, because in this case, E5 is violating the condition. What was the condition? That if there is any event, for example, E1, right? So in this case, or in this cut, one event is there, E1, which has happened before E5. And since E1 is there, E1 is not present in this cut, therefore we can say this is not a consistent cut. Okay, so this is how you can define the things in creating the consistent picture. Okay, now let us consider one more example. Well, if this is a message, yes. This is here again, same message. Okay, A2 is sending some message to A6. And this time, if we try to create a consistent cut, then it can be something like this. Okay, so all the events in the left side are denoting a consistent. Okay, so in this case, the H is going to have E1, E2, E4, and E5. Okay, because in this set, apart from these events, there is no any other events which you can claim has happened before this one. Right? For example, for E1, there is no such event which have happened before E1. For E2, there is no such event which has happened before E2, right? Similarly for E4 and E5. So this is the example of your consistent cut, and this one is the example of your inconsistent cut. Okay, so I hope the things are clear to all of you. This is the algorithm of Chandian-Lamport's algorithm to construct the consistent cut. Okay, so we need to send some marker, and then we will record the steps of all the processes, and then the moment you receive those markers or those things, then again these are the rules which you need to follow. Okay, so I'll explain in detail in the next class this algorithm, but before that, I hope you would have got what exactly we mean by the consistent picture of system and inconsistent picture of the system. So if there is any doubt, then you guys can ask. Otherwise, I'll end the class. Any doubt, any query? Students?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay then, students, thank you for attending the class. Next, let's meet the next one.
Thank you, sir.